everything, yet nothing happened to them. What should they do? In Bombay, we have 40 lakhs or more people live in slums. What is the government doing? Government is demolishing them. Your right to housing, internationally recognized right to housing, right to shelter, part of universal declaration of human rights, international covenant, civil and political, economic, social, cultural rights. All this is forgotten. Supreme Court has said repeatedly in the past, Article 21, right to life includes everything that goes with human dignity. Your food, your clothing, your shelter, your health, your education. What are we doing today? Everything we are not bothering. The government thinks it is not its business. The government thinks it is not their job. They're slowly abdicating their responsibilities. In a situation like, what should the people do? If you are thrown away from your house, you don't get justice in a court of law. What do you do? In Vidarbha, large number of people committing suicide. Repeated approaches, repeated appeals. Government is indifferent. Government is doing nothing. What should the people do? These are the questions. How do you answer? I remember once Arundhati Roy said, in a situation like this, where people get no justice, nothing happens to them. At that time, what happened to them is they refused to take this into account. I remember I went to Gujarat after the riots. Large number of young children have seen their mothers and sisters being raped and burned. Nobody guided them. Nobody gave them education. Nobody gave them any psychiatric treatment or anything. The trauma was there. What should they do? Who gave them justice? Could the system give justice or not? I do not justify taking arms, but a government has a responsibility. The government must take it into account, because if you don't care for the victims will try to take care of things by themselves. And that is the point. And so what Arundhati Roy said was, when victims refuse to be victims, they are called terrorists. So you are all victims of the unjust thing that is going on in this country, in this society. Government must take a major role. Not by bringing harsh law, not by creating counter-terrorist wardens, not by blaming a particular community or anything, not by doles, but taking care of human rights. Your right to food, your right to shelter, your right to education, right to health, right to a living livelihood. If these things are taken care of, automatically there will be change in the society. I think that is the goal that I want to tell you. Thank you very much for giving me this chance. Thank you.
Thank you, Justice Hosbath Suresh, for your frank judgmental comments on the injustice that we see around us, exposing reality before our audience is well appreciated by all present here. Once again in earnest, on behalf of the Islamic Research Foundation, I welcome each one of you present here at this interesting and serious talk. It would be followed by an open question and answer session in which you can ask Dr. Zakir Naik any question on the topic. As concerns about the causes and effects of terrorism rise, as distinguishing between war and peace, religion and politics gets difficult, as media reports instill in us a fear psychosis and Islamophobia amongst billions of people worldwide, we all wonder, and so does the world around Muslims, is terrorism a Muslim monopoly? Our speaker for today, Dr. Zakir Naik, is the president of the Islamic Research Foundation, Mumbai, and a medical doctor, an internationally acclaimed orator on Islam and comparative religion. Dr. Zakir Naik has delivered more than 1,000 public talks worldwide in the last 10 years. He appears regularly on many international TV channels in over 150 countries. Brothers and sisters, addressing the notion, is terrorism a Muslim monopoly? All yours, Dr. Zakir Naik.
Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam. Al-Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmain. Amma ba'd. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وقل جاء الحق وزاق الباطل إن الباطل كان زهوكا رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري وحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي Honorable Justice Hasbir Suresh, my respected elders and my dear brothers and sisters, I welcome all of you with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God, be on all of you. The topic of this evening's talk is terrorism a Muslim monopoly? First, let us understand what is the meaning of the word terrorism. It is very difficult to define the word terrorism. There are various different definitions, and many of them contradict. The definition is intangible. It keeps on changing depending upon the geographical location and the historical fact. It is very difficult to define terrorism. But according to the Oxford Dictionary, it says that terrorism is a use of violent action to get and fulfill a political aim or to force a government to act. This word terrorism was initially first time coined in 1790s during the French Revolution. And it was in 1790s that the statesman Edwin Burke, who was a British statesman, he used this word to describe the Jacobin ruled French regime. And the years 1793 and 1794, it was called the Reign of Terror, the Years of Terror. And Maximilien Robespierre, he was heading this government, and during that time, he has killed thousands of people. He has guillotined thousands of innocent human beings. Historical records tell us that he had arrested more than 500,000 human beings, out of which 40,000 he has executed. More than 200,000 were deported, and more than 200,000 they were starved and tortured to death in the prisons. So this word terrorism initially was coined to describe the people during the French Revolution. Today, we have in the international media, there is a very common statement which is repeatedly bombarded, especially in the Western media. And that statement is, all Muslims are not terrorists, but all terrorists are Muslims. And this statement was even imported to India, especially after the 11th July, the serial train bomb blast that took place in Bombay, especially to Bombay. And we find that even in India, especially in Bombay, people kept on repeating the statement that all Muslims are not terrorists, but all terrorists are Muslims. Let us analyze today what do the historical records tell us, and what does the data on terrorist attack that is available in world history, what do they tell us? When we look at the records, in 19th century, we can hardly find any terrorist attacks have been done by Muslims. Time does not permit me to speak about the details of the attacks taking place in 19th century. I'll just mention a couple of them. We know that in 1881, Tsar Alexander II of Russia, he was assassinated. He was traveling in a bulletproof carriage in St. Petersburg Street. There was a bomb that kills innocent 21 bystanders. He comes out of the bulletproof carriage, another bomb comes, and he's killed. He was not killed by a Muslim, he was killed by ignis. He was a Pole from Burbusk. He was a non-Muslim, he was an anarchist. We know